reviews are in, and we're going to tell you what they are. He's Todd Vandenberg, I'm Rob Steele, and because I introduced him first, I'm going to let you go first. See?
That is so
cool. It's polite of me and stuff. We've got, let's see, you've got a Marvel movie this week, right?
A Marvel Universe movie, yes, although it's not released by Marvel.
Well,
License? Yes. I'm talking about Spider-Man Into the Spider-Verse, which, of course, the trailers came out months ago, and it's an animated film, which is an interesting thing. I can't recall the last time one of the big two companies, DC, Marvel, put out a movie, an animated movie, for the big screen. We're not talking about the typically excellent DC animated movies, which, I mean, even The Killing Joke had a brief release, but it really, that wasn't the point of it. The point of it was
I don't think that counts. And I'm trying
exactly.
to, you mentioned that, and I'm running back through everything. I don't know that either of them have done that.
The last thing I can think of is Batman Mask of the Phantasm, and that's...
But that's based on the TV show.
Well, that's based on the TV show, but it was a theatrical release. It wasn't just...
All right, we'll count it.
But I mean, still, if that counts. This is a different animal. This is not just a one-week window to drum up a little hype for a video release. This is, you know, they're looking to make money at the movie theater. And Sony, of course, they've been kind of hit or miss with their Spider-Man movies. Those of you who remember Spider-Man 3, sorry. And actually, The Amazing Spider-Man, the two with Andrew Garfield, neither one of them just did it for me, which is why they changed and got some help from Marvel. This movie, I don't know if they got help from Marvel or not, but this movie is great. This is absolutely one of the best Spider-Man movies. And Into the Spider-Verse gives you a little clue. It's not just Peter Parker. It's several Spider-People, mainly Miles Morales, who is the Spider-Man from the Ultimate Spider-Man series. And this movie is just so well done. The animation looks terrific. It's kind of hard to describe the style. It's not the smooth animation that you'll typically think of for Disney, and it's not quite an anime style either. It's somewhere in between there.
They're talking about, was it patenting, the particular style they used, so it is a completely unique thing to this movie, if that helps.
Yeah, it is. It just looks great, and it absolutely fits the subject matter, because Spider-Man, lots of fast, jumping moves, obviously, and it fits. I mean, it's a very frenetic style, but not so fast-paced that it hurts your head to watch it. And because, you know, sometimes movies can, there's too much going on. That's not the case with this. But basically, the plot is Kingpin has opened up a portal, our buddy Kingpin, opened up a portal to another dimension because he's trying to get back his wife and son. And it's causing all kinds of problems, like other spider people are showing up. He doesn't want the other spider people because he just likes to kill spider people. He just wants his wife and son back. And of course, the spider people are going to try to stop him because this is going to basically destroy the planet that they're on. Not a fun concept. So Peter Parker there is a Peter Parker in the universe of Miles Morales. Different Peter Parker, but he's a Peter Parker. The Peter Parker we know pops back up through the universe. Then Gwen Stacy, and you may not know, but Gwen Stacy is Spider-Woman, or typically she's referred to as Spider-Gwen. She pops up in the universe to help. Three other spider people pop up to help, which are all very, very well done, very interesting. I mentioned Nick Cage on the show on Sunday. Nick Cage does one of the voices in this, which is kind of interesting. This is just so well done. The voice acting is excellent. It has kind of a surprising cast. For instance, Chris Pine shows up. Lily,
you can't make a movie without a Chris.
Yeah, not these days. Lily Tomlin, of all people, does a voice. It's just very, very well done. Now, here's an odd bit. I saw this in IMAX, which was great. There was a slight problem, and I wasn't sure while it was going on, and actually had to look later. Apparently, they showed us the 3D print without giving us the 3D glasses.
Oops.
And the interesting thing is that it still worked, but there were several times where images in the background were like triple overlaid because, you know, the 3D process, you have to have different images, and then the glasses bring them together. And I thought, well, that's a weird animation style because it's animated. it still worked. It just still looked like a strange artistic choice. But the more I thought about it, the more I thought, okay, this has to be. And it wasn't just that I missed it, because no one was wearing 3D glasses. And this was the screening for the non-3D version. They just showed the wrong version. And amazingly, it still worked, which tells me, and I've read reviews of the 3D version, and amazingly, it says it's more of just supporting detail. The main thing looks 2D, and it's just you get some depth because the stuff in the background. It's still amazingly watchable without the 3D glasses, which to me says that they did a really good job with the 3D, because it didn't need the 3D. It just added depth to the picture, and it wasn't like overthought. This movie is just so, so well done. Yes, there's a Stan Lee cameo, which is really well done. And yes, Stan Lee is animated, because this is not a live action movie. Extremely entertaining. I don't know if I liked it better than Spider-Man Homecoming, but maybe, or it's close. And to me, that's the best Spider-Man movie. This is in the running for the best Spider-Man movie. It is just so well done. The characters are so well played out, and there is some depth going on. Peter Parker has issues, because Pete always has issues. I mean, so true to the characters. It's just and like you said, I wasn't aware that they were applying for a patent for the style, but the style is just amazing. Absolutely great. And it's PG, so yay. You don't have to worry about, oh, my kids are too young for this. Very, very well done. And again, the cast is brilliant, and you'll see some interesting names there. Highly recommend Spider-Man Into the Spider-Verse.
I think, was it Liev Schreiber did Kingpin?
Yes, Kingpin. Yep.
Which, boy, that sounds like it would work.
Yeah, they didn't cut the budget, or they got them to work for a little money. But yeah, really, really good cast.
Well, the thing I did wasn't in theaters. It's on TV, kinda. It's not Marvel. It's DC.
Oh, yay.
And it's not in the least bit kid friendly. Oh dear. Although there are kids in it, but that's not the point. Wow. I looked at the Titans series, which is the first of the original series produced on the DC streaming universe, and it had its ups and downs. It started off very, very strange, very disjointed, and not at all the way the comics have ever portrayed the Titans before. Well, the characters are the same, but they didn't bring them together like this. Mm-hmm. But as it goes along, it really actually starts to come together. It starts to make more sense, although there are a few there are issues. Of course there are issues. It's based on a comic book. Comic books, whenever they come out, they're called issues. That should be a hint. The casting in this, some of it works, some of it doesn't. Tegan Croft plays Rachel, who ends up being Raven, who is the main focus of this entire series, basically with Raven, her father Trigon, who is essentially Satan in the DC universe, trying to make his way to Earth, has to be through her. Very strange premise there, but she meets up early with Dick Grayson, who last year was Robin. This year, nope, he's a detective. He's moved to Detroit. She talks him back into being Robin, at least for a few episodes. From there, they meet Ryan Potter, who plays Garfield Logan, who is Beast Boy. And here's where I originally had a problem with it.
Uh-oh.
Because Beast Boy, in all of his incarnations, has been green. It's just a thing. He's a green teenager who turns into animals. Well, so far in this series, he has turned into a tiger, and that's it. And the tiger is green. And when he turns back into a human, he's not green. His hair is green. I can make my hair green because I have Walmart, and they have hair green dye, green hair dye, something like that. Anyway, you know what? I thought that would bother me more than it did. But after a while, I realized they don't actually have to make him green, and that's fine. Similar to Anna Diop's Starfire, who doesn't actually get her name until, I think it's like 11 shows in. She's an alien character whose real name is Coriander, although she's on Earth with amnesia, dressed like a hooker a lot. That's something I didn't understand. But so they called her Cori Anders, Oh, okay. And then they just kind of squish it together when she gets her memory back, which I think is 11 episodes in or something. Sorry, spoiler. You knew she was going to get it back. I'm just telling you when. She still uses her powers. It did worry me that Anna Diop, and I apologize if I'm mispronouncing your name, is an African-American woman, as opposed to Starfire, who is Tamaranian, therefore orange. You know what? That stopped bothering me. The pink wig she wears still bothers me a little bit, but you know what? We'll let that pass. They're trying to figure things out. It's their first original series. Let it go. The special effects in the series are about on par with what we're getting out of shows like Arrow and The Flash, where there are moments of brilliance surrounded by a lot of, okay, that guy was on a wire. Okay, they did that effect doing this. Oh, look, Photoshop has shown up. That kind of thing. But you know what? The story, once it actually gets going, is pretty good. It's worth watching just to see how it evolves through the whole thing. They did bring in, and I think this is going to be interesting to see where this goes, they did bring in the Jason Todd Robin, who, if you don't know the books, Jason Todd replaced Dick Grayson as Robin. My problem with the Jason Todd character is really one thing, because they kind of nailed the character, except...
Oh, is he a jerk?
He's a dick. Which is ironic, no, because the previous one was also a dick, but that was his name, so it doesn't count.
Yeah.
Jason Todd wears too much eyeliner. I don't know why, he just does, and maybe that's just a personal thing for me. They end up introducing Donna Troy, who is Wonder Girl. Hawk and Dove are in the series, which is it's kind of weird. They're in the second episode, and we don't see them again until I think it's the 10th episode. Because there's a gap, because someone beat the crap out of Dove. I'm not going to tell you who, because I've forgotten the name of the character, really. Throwaway character? Yeah, just a little bit. But overall, you know what? It's actually a good series. No, it's not the Teen Titans, because I think the only teenage characters in this are Beast Boy and Raven. Everyone else is, you know, mid-20s. And like I said, it's not for kids at all. There's a lot of what some people dub inappropriate language. You probably got that from the trailer when you heard Robin say those infamous words. Not going to say them here because we're trying to keep this kid friendly. Anyway, it was in the
trailer. So something bad.
Yeah. Anyway, Batman does pop up in the series. Although, have I watched that show yet? No. Why? It came out today. And if you'll notice, this show comes out at 1 o'clock in the morning, which means we're recording it before Friday, because that's what we do. This show with Batman in it comes out on Friday. And seeing as I'm not psychic enough to project myself into the future, we'll have to find out together this afternoon, maybe, how Batman does in the Titans series. Oh, it'd be interesting. And if it's anything the way the rest of the series is done, which, like I said, it starts off weird, but does get to a point where it's a good series. So will I recommend it? Yes. Sit down, get yourself the DC streaming service, which I think is just $10 a month. But it's another one of those streaming services. But you also get access to, I think it's every comic book DC has ever put out.
They don't have access, at least from what I found, that you can't access everything, but they do have, there's a lot.
More than $10 worth.
Oh my God. At any given time, there's a ton that's available. They've got several movies, not all of them, but they do have several movies available. I think things rotate out. One thing I was really surprised, happily, is they have the old Dave Fleischer Superman cartoons from the late 30s and 40s.
Those were good.
And they, oh my God, they're good. And of course they're restored and God, they look amazing. So, I mean, it's just, yeah, I mean, DC Universe is definitely worth it. I mean, and yeah, I rail about all the time. Oh, another streaming service. But it's not that expensive. And I mean, obviously, if you don't care about DC characters, why would you do this?
Right.
But there's a ton of stuff available. And viewing the comics on your TV or monitor, whatever, however you're using DVD,
your tablet,
DC Universe.
Your phone.
Yeah, I mean, it works really, really well. I mean, this is a really cool concept, and you definitely get your money's worth.
So,
and I'm looking forward to watching Titans as well. Yeah.
So see, a couple things worth watching this week. And you've got a weekend coming up, so if you want to stay home, you can watch Titans. If you want to get out, go see Into the Spider-Verse. Either way, you should probably go see a movie. That's pretty.